is with us.
Things would have changed by now. Have you cried all the faith you have through so many tears? Don't forget the things that he has done before. And remember he can... It's like the brightest sunrise waiting on the other side of the darkest night. Don't ever lose hope, hold on and believe. Maybe you just haven't seen it, just haven't seen it yet. You're closer than you think you are. Only moments from the break of dawn. All his promises are just up ahead. Maybe you just haven't seen it, just haven't seen it yet.
Good morning. Welcome to Orange Coast Community Church.
Just a couple orders of business. Let's take our phones and let's turn them on vibrate. Let's turn them off. Also, I wanted to let everybody know that we got some cool stuff going on here. This is one of the best churches in the country, amen? Well, we are doing our best to try to get the word out about Orange Coast Community Church. And so we want to grow our presence online and on the radio. So this Tuesday, keep something in prayer. Pastor Rick has a 30-minute interview with AM 740. It's called K-Bright. It's the Christian radio station. He's got a 30-minute interview, and he'll let us know when that's going to be aired so that we can hear it. So keep him in your prayers on the 12th, on the 14th. And also wanted to let you know that Gabriel is doing some things on our website. We need to try to build our presence on a website. So if you can go online and make a review about Orange Coast Community Church, that will raise us up in a platform. When I was out of town last week, I googled Christian Community Church near me, and it came up. We want to be able to do that for somebody else that comes in here in our neighborhood that's visiting. They Google. We want to have Orange Coast Community Church come up with a bunch of reviews, and the only way that we get on the top of that list is by everybody in here going in and making a review. Okay, so make that a priority this week if you could, please. Also, we are going to storm the gates of heaven with our worship this morning because he put his breath in our lungs to sing. So stand and sing with us this morning, please.
Jesus Messiah. morning. Good morning. Great is our Lord. Amen. Greatly to be praised. We pray Him with our voices, and we pray Him with our praise Him with our actions, and we praise Him with our giving. And that's what it's time for. And the numbers, again, I think they are every Sunday, are right in front of us. Emails and all the ways that we repeat and regurgitate every Sunday about how you can get them here. So, please, when the Lord moves you, do as he moves. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. You, Lord, who have given so much, actually, you gave it all. There was nothing left to give. You gave your life for us. So we would just ask today, Lord, that it doesn't matter really how we came here, but it matters what you do to us and for us as we are here and what we can bring to you while we're here. So our prayers, like we've sung today, Lord, great is your love. We pray today for those with broken bones, broken hearts, broken spirits, Lord. Just all the things that they think they have needed to do have just seemed to have fallen through, Lord, and there's like just dead ends all over the place and, you know, wrong way signs. That's all of us at any given time. That's probably all of us in here right now in any certain points of our life, Lord. So we just ask, Holy Spirit, that you would just come right now, enter into every one of these brokennesses of it, Lord, and just lift this place up, your church, your body up today, Lord. Like Rocco said, I don't know about platforms or any of this stuff, but I know that we're here, and we in body and spirit and mind can just radically praise you today, Lord. We can come before you, and it's not so much about what I need, but what does the person next to me need? Something, Lord, that makes it different than the last time we were here. Please. It can't just be that we come and we do. And we No. Move in us today, Lord. I know where I need to be moved in. How about anybody else in here? Is there a place for movement, Lord? Please. We can't be so just downtrodden and beat down and, oh, my, this is my life, Lord. No, it isn't. There's a life that is new this next second and a new that's every minute and if we allow it. So that's what we're here for, Lord. Not just to get from you, but after we get it, what do we do with it? So I just want to thank you, Lord, for some of the things you've done. I see Brian here. That makes you smile. It really does. It just really does. And for all those who have been touched, Lord, here by you, help us not to focus on what we don't see, but praise you for what we do see. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for loving us like you do. And all your kids said. Amen.
By the way, Dave, you got some really sharp shoes on, buddy.
I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw my hands, praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, have nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing heart. your sign. Cause you got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Come on, my soul. Don't you get shy on me. Lift up your song. Cause you got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. So I throw up my hands, praise you again and again. Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, I'm nothing else before me.
Good morning.
Good morning.
They let me back. Oh, hallelujah. Welcome. We just sang. Thank you, guys. Hey. Give me a hand. Got to get these ready. The first song we sang was what? Let's see who. It was only like 10 minutes ago. That's it. I was just double checking. Okay. I saw the light. No more darkness, right? Okay. What we're going to see about and talk about today is a time that's coming. And Pastor just finished the millennial reign of Christ. Okay. Now, the thing about the millennial reign of Christ is it's something that's coming, but it's something that we can also live. We don't have to wait until he comes. We can be enjoying part of that, or the majority of it, now. Okay? I saw the light. I saw the light. Anybody here, lights going on today? And I mean, are we just driving?
Our lights are on, David.
Okay? Right? Okay, it's done. Donut, home. Okay? No. I saw the light. There's that song that's on the radio all the time now, right? Fear is not my future. Anybody hear that song?
Yes.
Okay. Fear is not my future. Who? He is. Fear is not my future. He is. Well, if fear isn't my future, why am I letting fear be my present? What? Why do I, if I don't have to wait for the millennial kingdom to joy part of it, why do I have to wait for there to be no fear then? If fear isn't my future, why is fear my present? Good answer. Because we won't let go of the fear. God's saying, any of you guys seen the light yet? Amen? What's up, David? So that's what he's singing when we say we saw the light. Not that we were just sinners that need to be saved by grace. But he's saying, I'm trying to get you to see the light of how you're supposed to live after you become children in Christ. So what we're going to be looking at is Psalm 72 today. Psalm 72. I'm going to read some verses first because I had some help last night, but I'll truncate that. We won't just get to the word. Amen. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, by your power, Holy Spirit, that you have allowed us in here to see the light. Not just the light of who we were and what your cross and your gift of salvation could do for us. That was the beginning. That was the beginning. Help us today to see the light, that there's things happening all around us. Yes. Yes, they're happening all around us. But oh, guess what else is happening even greater around us if we choose to see it. If we choose to see it. Every one of us in here have scars and wounds And we all have stuff, open wounds, things that we're dealing with. Yes, yes, yes. But every time I choose to dwell there longer than I should, it just cuts the time down where the light that you wants to bring into the, you want to bring into the newness of my life becomes shut off. Help us not to continue to focus on the things, the open wounds of our lives, the things that are happening in the world and all around us that want to make us just fixate. You want us to fixate, but on the right things. You and what you can do in the midst, as we're going to see, in the midst of injustice, in the midst of things, we go, if you're God, how can this be? You are God, regardless of time, nor space, or anything else. So my prayer is for me and everyone here today that we will see the light. We will see past the darkness of what the world looks like, because it is dark. Scripture tells us it's going to be dark, and it will be dark until you blow it up and give us a new one. Help us to look and see for the light and the things that you are doing today. It is still, we pray for your kingdom to come. This is yours. You just give it to the little g God until you come back. And even him, there's nothing. He's not doing anything that you don't first approve of. So, hallelujah. Let's see what you're going to do today. Amen. Psalm 72. So get there. We're going to start in Psalm 72. We're actually going to finish there, but I'm going to read a couple verses. You can jot them down. Okay. Deuteronomy 17. You can just, and you're going to go back to these later, hopefully. Okay. Deuteronomy 17, 16 and 17. Psalm 33, 16 and 17. 1 Kings 10, verses 1 and 2. And verse 14. Everybody got him so far? Okay. 1 Kings 11, 1 and 4. And 1 Kings 5, 13 and 14. Anybody need him again? Yes? Which one do you need? Everybody got 1 Kings 10, 1 and 2? And verse 14 there. 1 Kings 11. 1 to 4, okay, and 1 Kings 5, 13 and 14. We good? Okay, Deuteronomy 16, 17. We're going to look at things that start out in the light and then end up in the darkness. But we're going to go today from looking at darkness and ending up in light. Amen? Deuteronomy 17, 16 and 17. Now this is God speaking. But you shall not multiply horses for yourselves, nor cause the people to return to Egypt to multiply horses. For the Lord has said to you, you shall not return that way again. He brought them out of Egypt, out of slavery, bondage, all of the things that for 400 plus years they were being beaten upon and just abused to do bricks without straw. Then they had to go get their, all of those things, remember? He brought them out from that and told them, do not go back to that. He says, you don't, and you will no need to pass that way again. If God has brought us out, any of us in here from Egypt, and the bondages that we were in when we were in those places, why do we so easily, like the scripture says not to do we go back to these places and linger in them and kind of enjoy them for whatever reason? He's brought us out of them, folks. He's brought us out of them. Stay out of them. He doesn't bring us back. I go back. Okay? It's a key, not just for this, but for our lives. Neither shall you multiply wives for himself, lest the heart turn away, and nor shall he greatly multiply silver or gold. The king didn't need these things from the world. And guess what? Neither do we. If we're going to magnify or multiply anything in our lives, let it be what we've just sung about this morning. Let it be these things. Something that will enrich our lives, enhance our lives, encourage our lives. No, what hand did he say today? What did God say today? What is the first thing do I fill myself with and continually fill myself with throughout the day? Where do I keep going back to? Okay. Next, Psalm, remember that now. Do not multiply these things for yourself. Okay. Psalm 33, 16 and 17. Amen? No king, no president, no dictator. Look at what's happening. Just when you read these and hear these scriptures, think about what's happening in the world, okay? And what all these kings of the world are trying to do to store up for themselves for their success and the lengthening of their reigns, okay? No king is saved by a multitude of an army. Why? Because the Lord of the King's army is greater than any army that will ever be amassed on this earth. Amen. But we keep trying to get bigger bombs, more horses, different vaccines, different germs, all of these things. But fear is not my future. Amen. Keep running that. Fear is not my present. A mighty man is not delivered by great strength. Listen to all these guys running around on the news. They think they're all Schwarzenegger in his prime. It ain't happening. Because look at him 20 years later. Ain't nothing to be afraid of there. A horse is a vain hope for safety. So is a tank. So are jets and bombers and every missile that you can think of. It's a vain hope. Anybody feel safe when everybody's got bombs? Please, come on. Can there be a reality check in here? Anybody feeling safe? We all got bombs. We got big ships and things like that. Anybody feel safe?
No.
No. A horse is a vain hope for safety. Neither shall it deliver any by its great strength. Anybody here thinking they're going to get delivered by any government that's ever been created, including the one we have now? No. This is why he's called our creator and our redeemer. He will be the one. When all this is said and done, through the slop that we're calling life today, bring us home safely. Yes. Amen. One more. Actually, I gave you, but you're going to look those up yourself. 1 Kings 10, 1 and 2. 1 Kings 10, 1 and 2. Like Pastor says, it's nice to hear this. Old church. 1 Kings 10, 1 and 2. Now when the queen of Sheba heard of the fame of Solomon concerning the name of the Lord, she came to test him with hard questions. She came to Jerusalem with a very great retinue, means a lot of things she brought. With precious stones, she came to Solomon, okay? She had all kind of stuff that she came with, including very much gold. And we just read in Deuteronomy 17, 16, don't amass gold. Don't amass silver. What's it going to be worth? What's any of it going to be worth? Let us amass the trust in the God who says that only he can save. I think what we need, if we get anything from this message today, we need to start practicing fear is not my now. If it isn't my future, fear is not my now. If he is the coming, why don't we let him be the is now? Now. Is it a different is? Then is it going to be the God of the now? No. He's going to be the God who does everything he says he can do in the coming times for us now. And then in verse 14 of that same passage, it says, the weight of gold that came to Solomon yearly, okay, yearly, this was interesting last night, was 666 talents of gold. Anybody heard 666 before? He just happened to get 666 talents of gold. This is a year. You know how much gold that was in a year? 25 tons of gold a year. And he built so many things and ran out of the 25 tons of gold that he had to heavily tax the people of his country. You remember the story where Jeroboam and Rehoboam, his son, they came, the 10 tribes, your father taxed us so much, can you please give us some relief? He said, no. Matter of fact, my little finger will be like my father's waist. He whipped you with whips. I'm going to whip you with scorpions. So the taxes, you think our taxes are going to ever go down? No. You think anything's ever going to go down? Okay? So that's why the governments of today and the governments of then were not righteous governments. That's like the title. Remember the Righteous Brothers? You know, Bobby Hatfield, you know, Bill Medley, they could sing a righteous song. In the mid-60s, everything was righteous. Music was righteous. Your cars were righteous. Everything was righteous. Righteous shoes. I mean, yeah. Righteous. Nobody knew what righteous meant, but it was righteous. Anybody remember that? Anybody remember? Yeah. Righteous. Yeah. Yeah, righteous. That's righteous sandwich. But the problem was then, as it is now, there was nothing righteous. The only thing that is righteous is what God brings to us. Amen. Only God can bring righteousness. Okay? So, all of these things that are here in place in the world then and in the world now were not righteous, as we're going to see. We're not righteous. Why were there needy and poor and the oppressed? We're going to see in Psalm 72 throughout Scripture if everything was the way it was supposed to be. Why are the needy and the hurtful and the people who need help today if everything is as it's supposed to be? See, we keep looking for righteousness from an unrighteous world. We keep looking for righteousness from unrighteous leaders. We keep, you know, looking for love in all the wrong places. We are looking for righteousness to happen where there is no righteousness. You might meet a person who will do something nice for you righteously every now and then, once in a while. You have people in this church who do righteous things for people. But that's only because why? There's a Spirit of God inside of us. Amen. That's the only reason. Most people do something good every now and then and then put that in the back of their memory and go, because now if I need something, I'm going to that guy first. Why? Because he owes me. Right, joins me. That's not, and most of us give most of the things we do out of the goodness of our heart. Let's not get that wrong. But even the goodness of our heart isn't there if Christ isn't there. Okay, here we go. Psalm 72. And those other verses, look them up when you get home. There'll be a test. Psalm 72. Now, if you look at it, it says it's a song. A Psalm of Solomon. Okay? Now, if it's a song of Solomon, that means he wrote that psalm himself. He was penning that psalm. But as we get into this psalm, it's a psalm of Christ's reign. It's a coming situation. It's a coming kingdom. Okay? Because as we're going to, if you see on your own, Solomon's reign was not righteous. He had a lot of building projects. He did a lot of nice stuff. But he also took 30,000 of his own people and sent them 10,000 a month in rotation for every 3 months to go to Lebanon to cut trees to bring back for his building projects. okay? And he he taxed the people. There was all kind of things going on that were not righteous, okay? He was wise, but he also had 700 wives and 300 concubines. And Scripture says, like we saw, do not do that, because those women will turn and did turn his heart from the Lord. You let too much of the world into your life, it will turn you from the Lord, not draw you closer to the Lord. Because the things of the world then and the things of the world now have one meaning to them, is to keep you distant from the God who is righteous and the God who loves you. You take this thing to the world and they just start piling up, and pretty soon I'm here and the Lord's there. The only thing that's keeping the distance between us are the things that we allow out there to come in here. We control that. Nobody fills me with anything. I choose who I want to fill my life with. I choose what I want to fill my life with. I choose how much turmoil I want. I choose how much peace I want. I choose that. You know, it's not some fairy dust thing flying around in my bedroom. I go, worry, turmoil. It's already in here. What the righteousness of God does, if I allow it, is to bring it back out and leave, just put it where it belongs, away from us. Amen? So this is going to be a song for Solomon, which means the author of that would have been who? David. And keep in mind, as we go through this psalm, he was speaking of his son, right? Successor, Solomon. Also looking forward to the next and last king of David, who will be Christ. Amen? So, verse 1. Now, verses 1 to 4 is a righteous reign. A righteous reign. That's what everybody wants right now. We want righteousness. We want righteousness to reign in an ungodly world. Why do you think there's so much vexing and anxiety? Because we are looking for all this stuff to happen in places where it's never going to happen. And when it doesn't happen, we get frustrated, angry, we get turmoil, we get all jacked up, and we're like, right? Okay? We got to look for the right things in the right places. And what's the right place to look for it? Who's the right person to look for it from? See how simple I try to make it? Because you might know some simple people, but you can put me at the top of your list. Because I'm just, like Pastor said about 47 times last week, keep the cookies down here for Dave, all right? Not just because I eat a lot of cookies. Okay, verse 1. Give the king your judgments, O God, and your righteousness to the king's son. What does he want for the king and the kings to come? God's righteousness. He's not saying, give him more gold, more horses, more this, more that. Please, give him and them wisdom. I'm not going to mention any names, because as soon as I say it, you're all going to go to the person you think it is. Presidents, senators, whatever. When you turn the TV on, whether it's the talking heads behind the desk, whether it's the talking heads behind the microphone, can you tell me, seriously, when the last time you heard a drop of wisdom come out of any of their mouths? Please, anybody heard any real wisdom being spoken? None. Zero. Cats and dogs run for cover when these people speak. There is nothing that they're saying that is uplifting, There is nothing they're saying that is bringing a peace to your soul. Nothing that they're speaking that is giving you any hope for a future. Anybody in here, truthfully, except I'm not talking about Christ and Christ in our lives and Christ coming. Anybody here, when you listen to these people talk, have any hope for a future?
No.
None. None. But we keep listening. Oh, yeah. Maybe today you'll get something smart. Today. Because why? They are all connected to the hope that is coming in having lots of horses and gold. What's the old saying? He who has the most gold, what? Wins. Scripture says you can have all, you can have 25 tons of gold a year and you lose. Verse 2. And he will judge your people with righteousness and your poor with justice. Okay. When you see, and all of us in here, whether we have to pay the same amount of things for chicken, gas. I don't even want to talk about electric bills. That's a different story. Utilities, all of these things. If we are struggling with these things, and we're wondering how we're going to make a food budget and the rent and everything else, what are the poor and the needy doing? If we're struggling, how are they existing in the same world that we're existing in? But what is the government's problem? Well, we'll just print $70 trillion and just start giving it out. Okay, that's a great temporary fix, a day fix, a week fix. What happens with these people, all, and not just the poor, the needy, us, long term. We turn these things on, and our attention span is this long, but our rationale thinking is even less than that. We don't even take what they're saying and trying to rationalize the nonsense of it anymore. They don't understand we're being led by people without a clue. And they do have an end. Whether it's to crash America, whether it's to crash the country, whether it's to crash the world and bring in all their eco things and there'll be windmills and doves and all, whatever it is. It's a pipe dream. It's from this pit of hell. It will never happen. It will happen. And it's going to be exactly the way they wish it will. But you know what's happening? It's happening now. Everyone in the world then will become the poor and the needy, which is exactly what they need to happen. Because they still, in the recesses of their mind, thinking they are God. But they will be shown soon that they are not God. There's only one God. Amen. And when he comes, and the reality of it is, whether it's spiritual or is it physical, we are continually, please, Pastor, we are here today poor and needy in some place of our life. And is anybody here going to say, no, not me. I am. He's taking care of that now, but he's going to take care of all of it then. The poor and the needy we need to channel and refocus where we put our trust. Psalm 33, you don't put our trust in horses. We don't put our trust in anything other than the Word of God and the God who gave us that Word. Anything else, friends, is futile. Futile. Do what you think you can do, but if you think when the crap really starts hitting the fan, that it's going to help you, you can have 17 Uzis. You can have a 50 cal on your roof. Like Ted Nugent says, I got 800,000 rounds in my house. But you better believe you don't need 800,000 and one. No, is anybody, if you're not agreeing, fine. But if you're agreeing, is it right or wrong? Amen. The mountains, now look, this is what's interesting. The mountains will bring peace to the people. The little hills by righteousness will bring justice to the poor and the people. He will save the children of the needy and break the backs of the oppressor. Did that happen in Solomon's time? No. Is it happening in our time?
No.
No. The oppressors are becoming more oppressive.
Yes.
Day by day. Day by day. And again, it's not by name. It's just by the name fits what we're talking about. This Prime Minister Trudeau. Sanders, they just arrested a pastor up there. What was he arrested for in Canada? They got him in jail.
Being thrown out of a child's
Yes, so he went when they're doing all this stuff for the kids. Yeah. Friends, again. And if that pastor's here for going to that, this is Orange Coast Community Church, and if you get this in Canada, this church stands with you for you going to a council meeting and saying you're not going to take a bunch of cross-dressers and people in G-strings with beards and teach it to our kids.
Amen.
So, don't know your name right now, but we're praying for it. It's like that man with the seven went to the abortion clinic and they showed up 17 people with no identifications and Uzis and knocking on their door with the kids there because the guy was praying outside of an abortion clinic. And that's convicting me. It's like I preach about it, but I direct me to do something about it. Oh, them Catholics. Years and years ago, I used to go and stand with the Catholics in front of that abortion mill down there by the 22 freeway. I don't do it anymore, but I don't know if God, I'd go back, I'll stand with them ladies with their rosaries. I don't care. If they're praying for the salvation and the care of those babies, you know what? God bless them. They're doing something. They're standing there for righteousness. So, amen. And the next time I should open my mouth to say, let God shut it and say, praise Him for doing it. Praise Him for doing it. And it's interesting, okay, the mountains and the hills, we're going to go bring peace. Think about it. We're going to see later on. The mountains, with all the snow been on them, to the littlest hill. In that whole area, there is going to be peace for people.
Wow.
It means from mountain to hill, wherever you see, there's going to be no turmoil. It's going to be a time from wherever you can see to the lowest spot, there will be peace. There will be prosperity. There will be no angst. There will be nothing in it except being able to revel and relax in who God is.
Yes.
From that part, to the far, you can go from the mountains to the ocean, it's going to be at peace. At peace. Can we even imagine that? We can't even conjure that in our minds. Our minds can't even go, what would that be like? We're so used to living in the turmoil. We're so used to living in the agitation of what people want us to hear and believe that we can't even imagine peace anymore. Anybody wake up in the morning and go, this is a peaceful day. I just can't wait to get out into the world. But you know what? That should be my attitude.
I know.
We laugh, but it's the truth. We wake up going, oh, shame. Put on my high boots today. If we're waiting for the level of the to go down, it ain't going to happen. It's not going to happen. It's like the ubiquitous dog turd. You're always going to be stepping in one out there. As soon as you get outside the door, Yeah, that's what it is. Why do we expect anything different? Amen. And a day when all these oppressors will be broken. Now, we're going to look at verses 5 through 11, which is a worldwide reign. Solomon didn't have a worldwide reign, but the coming one greater than Solomon will. Verse 5. And they shall fear you. They will reverence you as long as the sun and the moon endure throughout all generations. Pastor's been talking about it. We notice it in church here. Where are, Zachary, God bless you. I just, there's another young person here that I'm missing. God bless you too. The generations that we have raised, including my family, pastors, the ones that we know, cousins, children, nephews, nieces, where are they? God bless you in the back, the twins, Brandon, all of the ones, David, that are still here. Hey, Ben, thumbs up. I can't see you behind Lawrence's head, but that's all right. No problem. Hey, where are they? They were raised here, baptized here. Did I picture Christ as often as I should have? No. Was I this father that wanted them to stay or see a father in heaven? Most of the times, no. But that's not how faith works. They, of that generation, have to have their own faith. Amen. I can drag them in here. But if I drag them in, they're going to run out.
That's right.
So we do what? We pray that that righteousness of who God is will find them. And we're going to see soon in the end of this chapter, there's no wilderness that you can go to where God ain't going to find you. Amen?
Yeah.
Verse 6, and he shall come down like rain upon the mown grass, like showers that water the earth. His days of the righteousness shall flourish, the abundance of peace until the moon is no more. Like we've been seeing for the last month, and sometimes it gets a little irritating. But before the rain, what were we saying? We need some rain. We need some rain. You look in the backyard, the dirt's all cracked, it's pulling apart, there's nothing growing, not even the weeds. But what happens? Like Christ, when the rain came down, and I don't mean that beating, pounding rain, but like last night when it's that mist that comes. And you can kind of walk in it, and it's refreshing, and it doesn't really get you wet, but it kind of just wakes you up. That's what it's going to be like. When Christ comes, there's going to be a mist of peace that flows from the mountains and the hills, and it will renew and bring to life everything it touches. Just like the rains that have been falling for the last 2 or 3 weeks. Things where there was nothing, nothing. Come in anybody's backyard. You got weeds here. You got green things you don't even know what you are. Springing out of a patch of dirt that ain't had nothing green on it for 10 years. And it says, I ain't going to put a shovel in it because I got to go buy a new shovel. It's just, you just went, man, that's done. But that's our thought process as humans. That's done. But there's a mist and a rain of life that's going to come that renew and refresh everything.
Yes.
And the thing that renewing mist and everything is right here, right now.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody feel like dry ground in here? Does anybody feel like there's nothing really to make anything new or fresh, green, come back out of our lives again? He's waiting to just rain on me, rain on you,
yes,
to take that part of your life and refresh it and renew it. Anybody in here feel fresh and renewed?
Yes.
Amen. Amen. What do I do with my glasses? Oh, hallelujah. And it will be, at the end of verse 7, an abundance of peace, friends. An abundance of peace. There's an abundance of a lot of stuff today, but not an abundance of peace. Right, Christine? Not an abundance. She's going here. Is peace available?
Yes.
We sing it. When peace like a river tans my soul. Right? It doesn't say peace like a brook. Peace like a little crick. And if you're back east, it is crick. It ain't a creek. I never went down to the creek. But it's peace like a river there to attain my soul. Now, I can look at the river, go, that's a nice river. I can let the river just roll on by, because what do rivers do? They just keep passing by. I can sit on that same stone and watch that river flow by day and night. Or I can take what is in that river and appoint it to my life. I can either watch it flow by, or I can take it and let it do something in my life. Verse 9, those who, again, when it comes to our kids, people that we're praying for, that we think they're so far out in the wilderness that they're beyond hope, here's hope. That's what I'm saying. We've given up on them. Oh, there's no hope for that one. Anybody ever, that ain't never going to happen. No hope. They're so far out. They're so, okay, listen. Listen what God's word says. Those who dwell in the wilderness will bow before him. Those in places that we don't know exist, God knows exists. Those who are the Bedouins, those who are in far back then, 2,000 plus years ago, that they didn't even know what land masses it really existed, what oceans, you didn't even know all of it. God's word says, when they were out in some wilderness, which means some place you've never seen or heard of, they will find me. Right? What does scripture say? If you seek him, you'll what?
Find
him. So in the farthest wilderness of places, he will find you and you will find him. And the truth be known, all of us in here, before we knew Jesus, our lives were a stinking desert. It was a fruitless, treeless wilderness. Oh no, my life was... We needed Jesus. Amen. If we needed Jesus, that means we were in a wilderness. Does that make sense? Life apart from Jesus is a wilderness. Christ comes into our lives and brings us out of that. A wilderness is what? You get in the wilderness. You ever watch them escape, like, you know, 40 days with a spear, no clothes, and you got to eat a bug or something every other day? Right? So you go there and you're going, plus, I don't know, why does anybody even volunteer for that show? Is what I don't know. But anyway, that's a whole different story. But when you go there, and then they're naked in the wilderness with a spear and eating cockroaches. So even in that place, our places. That's what our lives looked like before Christ. Then he brings us out from there, out from that wilderness. So everybody in here, including myself, we were in a wilderness. We didn't think so. We were thinking we're living pretty good. Took me 25 years to get here. And God's going, really? And we go, after we've done it, driven it, drank it, whatever it is, we go, there's nothing in this wilderness. And that's when Jesus says, now you're at the right spot. Mm-hmm. Now you know what you need in that wilderness, and it's Jesus. Mm-hmm. If there's anybody, Pastor Rick or myself, if there's anybody in here that is still in that wilderness of not knowing who Christ is in their life, please, 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 do not leave today. Grab Pastor. Grab who brought you, but let Christ enter into that wilderness.
Amen.
That he so longs to come into.
Yes, yes.
But his enemies are going to do what? They're going to lick the dust, which means they will be prostrate. You think you're going to stand before God? You will not stand before God. We will be flat on our faces in praise, and they will be flat on their faces, not because of praise, but because they finally have come to see who they thought they were and who God really is. And the kings of Tarshish, which is in Spain, and of the Isles, which is just the far-flung places that they didn't even know what they were. They just figured there was something out there. Will bring presents. And everybody goes, well, if it's Solomon, what about the Queen of Sheba? What scripture say? It says the kings of Sheba. Okay? No kings from Sheba came to see Solomon. And Sheba will offer gifts. Yes, all the kings shall fall down before him. All nations shall serve him. So what's coming? Or any of these entities, enemies, or whatever, of the state, all these gulags and all, they're all going to be empty. All these people who are serving righteously in these prisons will be released. God has a special, he knows where they're at. And he's going to bring them out, and he will be treated, and they will be retreated with the respect that they deserve for standing for him. Whether it's in North Korea, whether it's in China, all these people that we want to cotton up to have our brothers and sisters in these prisons locked down for God knows how long, or this people, whatever, you know, I'm going to get anywhere, January 6th, any of these people that are inside for doing something they thought was right in a country they thought was free, God has a place for them. God has a place for them. Okay? So, when we say, well, what about that person? God knows the person who is being treated unjustly. He knows the person who has been jailed, imprisoned, killed, murdered, tortured for him. He knows everyone. Can he make himself peace to them? Why do you hear, like, unbroken, these men who went through the most horrific things that we can ever imagine and came through and came to Christ? How many of us in the worst of situations came to the realization that we needed to know who Jesus is? So what we need to do is pray and know and give thanks that God knows where these people are, what they're going through, and he can be their strength and their peace while they're going through it. He shall deliver, verse 12, and he shall deliver the needy when he cries, and the poor also, and him who has no helper. He will spare the poor and the needy and save the souls of the needy. He will redeem the life from the oppression and violence, and precious shall be their blood in his sight. That's what we were just saying. All the oppressed, all those who are dying unrighteously, all those who are where they're at, God knows. And how precious is their blood in his sight. He will be with them going through it, and they will be with him after they've gone through it. Please, friends, understand that. He is with them. He is with us through all of this thing that's going on. And eventually, we will be with him. Those who have died already, their blood is so precious that when they're done with what they've had to go through, now they're in the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
And do you think when they get there, what they've gone through, they'll remember?
No.
No. Do you think as we're going through this, we're going to remember when we get there to heaven? No. But why do we cling to it so much here? I got a bag full of something. I'll just keep adding. God says, why don't you empty your bag? Why don't you take all that stuff you're dragging around and just like leave it on the side of the road? You know, there's never not a time when you can't start over. Amen. Amen. There's been some stuff you've been wanting to deal with. Why not start it over today or now? Drop the bag. No, okay. Got a bicep this big from carrying that bag. God says, why don't you just drop it on the side of the road? And you ever see hitchhikers? They don't got 17 suitcases. Who's going to stop for them? You need a, come on. We used to want to hitchhike before when you could still hitchhike. You had, if you were lucky, you had about a buck and a half in your pocket and nothing else. Where are you going? San Diego. And we used to do that. You'd have a dollar. Dollar, and we'd hitchhike to San Diego. My buddy, who now is extremely wealthy, we would hitchhike from Covina to Santee because he had to get his unemployment check, which was like $32. No, seriously, we would hitchhike from Covina to Santee to get an unemployment check and then hitchhike back to Covina. And then you'd find, that's when they had little things on the telephone poles when people were semi-sane, even though they were all full of drugs. And you would go to knock on a door and go, hey, we need a place to crash. Ah, come on, there's a bed over there. And you'd go in and lay down. No, sir, I mean, come on. You know, he slept with his eye open. I slept with the other eye open, just in case. But that's what we used to do. That was either stupidity or freedom, or a little bit of both. Okay, but that's what God's saying. We didn't go down there with a bunch of Elises. We had a buck and a half and with thumb, and we left and didn't care. Didn't worry about it. We didn't even know God, but we figured something happened. You find a bunch of guys with a bottle of wine, a couple guys eating some chips. Hey, here's a Dorito. And it was all you needed. Now, no, seriously, friends, that's what it was. Now it's like, you know, you got double, you know, check, 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 17 shoes. I got, I got 17 underwear. I'm going for 2 days. Okay, yeah. Then you get home and you roll up your T-shirts and then you get home and you unroll 17 T-shirts and you put them back in the drawer. But that's how we live our lives, friends. God says simplify. Simplify. Verse 15. So 15 to 17 is a plentiful reign of our God. He shall live, and the gold of Sheba will be given to him. If you read, write it down, you want to read it in your own Isaiah chapter 60, verse 6, you can write that down. In the millennial reign, that's what happens. They bring the, and it says, gold from Sheba will be brought into Jerusalem. Okay, go home and read it. Isaiah 60, verse 6. And the prayers will be made for him continually, and daily he shall be praised. They're not going to be made for him. When Christ is there, the praise and the prayers aren't going to be for him. They're going to be to him. They're going to bring everything to him. Their prayers will come to him. Remember, these, in the millennial reign, these are humans that made, like Pastor been teaching, these are humans that made it through. So they're going to be living this life from, remember, before the millennial reign, when everything was blowing up, and they're going, wow, this is pretty nice. This is pretty cool. And they're going to be praying that this reign of this God who is sitting on this throne will continue for a long time. If I'm in the skin bag and I see this God sitting there and everything's really nice and the refreshing rain's coming down and there's wheat growing on top of the mountains and everything's good, I'm going, please, please, I'm going to pray for this, that this continues. Amen? I would. But what we have to understand is, has God's kingdom ever stopped? No. So we're praying, Lord, your kingdom come. We're praying for a kingdom to come where everything will be of refreshing rain and the grass will be growing and corn on the mountains. Why aren't we praying that his kingdom comes as he wants it into my life? I'm not going to see it here. Outside of the millennial reign. But his kingdom is everywhere. His kingdom is everywhere. I just have to invite the peace of that kingdom into my life. And there will be on the tops of mountains, the fruit shall wave like Lebanon. We got fruit growing on the mountains? Up in the mountains? No, it's rock and snow. There will be abundance of grain in the earth. On the tops of mountains, fruit shall wave like Lebanon, and those of the city shall flourish like grass of the earth. When we look around at the world today, you see famine. There's nothing growing in some places, and people are eating, like if you see voice, they're eating mud balls, or they're making these mud cookies for their children. There is no flourishing and abundance of grain in most places. But when he comes back, there will be. Verse 17, and his name shall endure forever. His name shall continue as long as the sun. And men shall be blessed in him. All the nations shall be blessed. When Pastor did Revelation, the new heavens and the earth is going to be a sun and a moon. But they're only going to be there in their form. We don't need their function anymore. Why? Because the Son of God is there. He is the light. I don't care how dark you think it feels today. He is still and will be the light. We curse the darkness instead of inviting in the light. I guess it's right. Thank you. I get three or four, that's right. For my sister back there. We curse the darkness. And God is saying, why don't you invite in the light? Verse 18 and 19, the glory-filled rain. Blessed be the Lord God, the God of Israel, who only does wondrous things. Okay? Extraordinary thing. Anybody here had a wondrous thing done for him?
Yes.
Anything. Anybody here had a wonder? Yeah, don't be afraid. Yeah. I don't think there ain't nobody in here that God hasn't done a wondrous thing for. Realized or not, the car that didn't hit you, the car when you kind of went through and all of a sudden look at, there was an 18-wheeler that just went by a millennial second before you got there. Everybody in here has had that extraordinary, wondrous work done in them. And if you can't think of any, not one, look at the cross. There will be no greater wondrous work than the gift of salvation. If I get no other wondrous gift, no other wondrous work except for that, praise the Lord. Let the whole world be filled with his glory. Amen and amen. The prayers of David, the son of Jesse, are ended. So what we just saw and studied was a prayer of David for his son and for the King of all kings who will come and follow. Amen. Let's pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, thank you. We really do. We thank you so much. We were, all of us who were in that wilderness place. And for any however reason, Lord, for those in our families, those who we pray for today that might sense that there's no way that you know where they're at, you do. We just pray for them today, Lord, that they would just look up and say, Lord, I need you. I need you. This desert land is just tiring. It's just wearing them down. And for us who are saved, who know you, but still walk around sometimes, a lot of the times, like we're still in the wilderness, parched and dry, and oh my goodness, where's the peace? Where's the things? And they're right there. It's that river that's flowing right by, that river of peace. So if there's anything, Lord, that by your power, Holy Spirit, that we get from this, that we can bring into any of our lives, not in huge chunks, but just maybe even a small bite, a morsel, that river of peace that's flowing by in a world that is blowing up. It is, and it's going to blow up more tomorrow. It's going to blow up until you come back. Can we kind of just dip our feet, if it's even a toe, once in a while, into that river of peace? That our lives can slow down a little bit. Enough to know that you have not left your throne. You have not left your throne. Never have, never will. If you read Scripture, Solomon built himself a throne and then he covered it in gold. Where is that throne today? Gone. So are the 25 tons of gold. He got a year. Gone. It said every drinking goblet in his house was gold. There was not one of silver. Let us seek you, Lord, as precious gold. You alone. To the changing, the uplifting, the excitement that you want to bring into our lives. And again, if you're here and you don't know this Jesus, please don't leave the same way as you came. Grab any one of us. We'll tell you about this wonderful Lord. And God's people said,
amen. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor David, for that great exposition of Psalm 72. You know, as I listen to David preach, I realize God's really given him a great ability when it comes to application. I hope you see that he could take ancient scripture and almost every verse he finds something applicable for us today. That's a gift to God. Thank you so much, my friend. We want to just draw your attention to an event that we have every year, and that's Good Friday. And each Good Friday, the elders get together, and we take a theme, and we follow it through. And this Good Friday, which will be April the 7th at 6 p.m., the elders will be speaking on the topic, Heaven's Prince in the Presence of Pilate. Heaven's Prince in the Presence of Pilate. So we'll all be looking at the interplay and taking a small portion of what happened between Pilate and Christ on that special event. Well, let's stand together with our worship team.
Well, I was looking for a gold nugget to walk away with. You know what I got? Drop the bag. Drop the bag.
Hey, Rock, I think that's Sean.
Hello.